time to give them. Right, so what we're going to do now is, in a moment, I'm going to ask each of the panelists to briefly introduce themselves. So Deborah's already given you just a few words about themselves, but they can, if they choose, say more about themselves that might be of relevance to what they're going to say tonight. And then just, I guess, kick off with a few points for a maximum of 5 minutes that perhaps sets the tone for the discussion. We don't want this to be a lecture or a series of little talks, but some opening, as we like to say, in our provocations to get you thinking and talking and asking questions. If there's a lull in the questioning, I'll step in and ask some of my own, but I expect that you'll be able to ensure that we don't have too many gaps of that nature. And I think we might just kind of go along in the order in which you're presented, and start with you, Brendan, and ask you to kind of say any more about yourself that you're happy to reveal that's of relevance, and, sure, and kick off with a few provocations.
Sure. So I'm an ecological scientist. So I'm interested in how climate change affects ecosystems, and also how humans use and interact with ecosystems. And I'm also interested in the science-policy interface, what kind of policies we need to help humans manage how they use ecosystems and how ecosystems are responding to the changes that we're witnessing. On the science-policy side, I also have a role. I serve on the Global Governing Council of the IUCN, International Union for the Conservation of Nature, which is the peak international body conservation environmental body. It's got about 1,200 member organisations. It's unusual because it's got government and non-government organisations. Queensland Park Service is a member, or the Environment Department. The Australian Government's a state member. And the IUCN is unique, and it's the only environmental body which has got formal UN General Assembly observer status, which means it's got IGO, intergovernmental observer status. So it can participate in UN treaty negotiations, including climate change treaty negotiations, where it's able to bring an ecosystem-based approach to issues of adaptation and mitigation.
Good. Can I ask you, let's do it like this. I'll ask you a kickoff question.
Okay.
And then we'll move along the panel. So in terms of reducing our greenhouse gas emissions, burning fossil fuel for energy, we hear a lot about that, a lot of discussion about that. But I, for one, don't have a very clear idea about how much we would have to reduce those emissions in order to come to, I mean, either to solve the problem, whatever that might mean, or to come to a position that we're comfortable with either nationally or internationally.
Yeah, so internationally, all the world's governments, one or two, but 98% of them, have signed an international treaty called the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. They signed that in 1992, and the goal of that is to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, to stabilise atmospheric concentrations of greenhouse gases, to prevent what the treaty calls dangerous human interference with the climate system. And it's called a framework convention because it provides a framework for negotiating specific protocols and agreements through time. You would have heard of the Kyoto Protocol, that's one of them. One of the negotiated decisions was that the governments agreed that dangerous climate change, if you like, would be represented by a target. We would aim to limit global warming to no more than 2 degrees above pre-industrial temperature. It's a statistic. You take what the average planetary surface temperature was in 1800, say, and we want to limit global warming such that the average planetary surface temperature will be no more than 2 degrees above that. And we're about approaching 1 degree above it now, or we're a bit more than that actually. Now, So that target of 2 degrees, and it's called the 2 degree guardrail, okay, that it follows that there's a very specific amount of carbon that we can emit before we hit that 2 degree warming. And it's about 1,000 billion tons of carbon dioxide. Well, how much is that? You're dealing with molecules of stuff, you know. It's about 34 years of our current global emissions from burning fossil fuel and deforestation. So we can keep doing what we're doing on an annual basis for 34 years and then zero emissions, right? That's the good news. The good news is there's a permissible amount, it's called the carbon budget, and it's about 34 years of what we're doing at the moment.
Presumably after 34 years of ignoring it.
We fall off the cliff. So obviously the sensible thing to do is not business as usual for 34 years and then zero emissions. You would want to, we'd want to contract global emissions in a steady way over a period of time and replace those fossil fuel sources with renewable sources, you know, that weren't carbon emitting. So basically we have to, but it's still a pretty severe contraction curve, okay? Basically we've got to get down to close to zero emissions by about 2080. And we really need about 80% emission reductions by about 2050.
And the 2 degrees, 2 degree guardrail as you put it, that's considered, I mean, I'm sure there's argument and dispute about it, but that's something that we feel we could live within. We could live with the consequences of that without it being too onerous, but presumably the more we go over that, the more onerous those impacts would become.
Yeah, so these are projections based upon our understanding of the global carbon cycle and the global climate system as represented by global climate models, it does have a scientific basis to it. But above 2 degrees, we're going to start to elicit more of these so-called positive feedbacks, and we're going to start to get levels of impact that are going to be potentially locking us into catastrophes.
Yeah.
And the kind of scientific consensus is if we can limit global warming to 2 degrees, we are still going to have really major significant climate change impacts for millennia.
Yeah. Right?
Because this is how we've perturbed the Earth's system. It takes a long time for the Earth's system to reach a new dynamic equilibrium. But we can not prevent climate change, but limit it, and hopefully it will be within our capacity to adapt and avoid the worst of the catastrophic impacts.
But those adaptations could well be quite profound and costly and
they will still be
challenging.
Even at 2 degrees, it will be profound and costly. The range of atmospheric concentrations that will deliver 2 degrees warming are between about 450 to 500 parts per million. We're currently at 400. For the last million years, we haven't been above 280. So we're actually somewhat, I mean, we are having impacts. There will be more impacts.
Yes.
The international community has tried to set a goal which they feel is achievable as much as anything else, for which there's some scientific basis. It doesn't eliminate the climate change problem, if you like, caps it.
Yes.
At a level which hopefully is within our adaptive capacities.
Yes. So just hold those thoughts and your thoughts that might have been provoked by Brendan's initial comments, and we'll just move along the row and then perhaps become a bit more discursive. So Gene, do you want to say a bit more about yourself that you think is of relevance before I throw a question at you?
No, but I will say a bit about income.
Okay.
So I'm the director of the National Climate Change Adaptation Research Facility, which is based here at Griffith on the Gold Coast, and its job is actually to think about adaptation nationally. Even though we're here in Queensland, we actually have a national remit to look at adaptation. And we're currently working on a three-year project funded by the federal government in Canberra, and it has a specific goal, which is to support decision makers in the coastal zone to think about sea level rise and climate change and what it is that we can do to protect ourselves against the effects of coastal inundation and coastal erosion as these become worse because of sea level rise. So we've got a three-year project to do that. It's actually quite lonely because there's not a great deal of work on adaptation going on at the national level in Australia now. But we are progressing our activities, and we're working particularly with local councils to try and empower them to think about adaptation, what it is that they need to do in order to ensure that their communities are safe.
Good.
That'll do.
Thank you. And a bit like me, Jean, you've been in Australia for 7-ish years, and prior to that, like me, Jean was in the UK, latterly at the Met Office, and before that at the Anglia, renowned institution for its work on climate science and climate change.
Indeed, yes.
So, the question, and this one or two of you might have seen a similar lineup of people in a slightly different order a week ago at a book launch when Jean made some very interesting remarks about the role of scientists. And my first question to you, Jean, is do you think that scientists and academics, because there's not always a perfect correspondence between the two, are always, or indeed ever, the best people to convey the fruits of their scholarly endeavour to politicians and to policymakers to maximise the chance that those policymakers and politicians will listen to what they have to say?
I think a scientist who, so they're not mutually exclusive, just because you do science doesn't mean that you can't communicate.
No.
I think we all know scientists who are not particularly good at communicating. And I don't think most people went into science with the idea that they would become communicators. Indeed, many people go into science because it's nice to hide in the laboratory and you don't actually have to go out and talk to people. You can actually just talk to your mice. So, and it's become a challenge because people who then thought, okay, I like climate models and I'm good at physics and I like to understand how the climate system works and I think I've got something to say about this, they got themselves into a job where indeed they could do all those things, but then came along this additional task that they had to do because they felt responsible for their knowledge, really, which was to go out and to persuade people of the reality of what they had found. So what they had found was, if you add greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, it gets warmer, and if it gets warmer, there's more energy in the atmosphere, and then all kinds of difficult things happen. It gets hotter, you have more heat waves, sea levels begin to rise, you may have more storms, it may get much wetter, it may even get much drier in some places. So they felt an obligation to go out and talk about this to policymakers and try and persuade them that actually there was a need to do something. And the thing that they needed to do was to reduce their emissions of greenhouse gases. And that's a very uncomfortable truth for policymakers, and most governments are really very bad at thinking about doing something about climate change. And the reason is, I guess the main reason, and my colleagues might disagree with me on this, but it seems to me that the main reason why governments are so unwilling to act is that it's a problem that you can defer. You don't have to think about it now. You might say, I can think about it in 20 years, 30 years, but there are lots of things I want to spend my money on right now, and one of them is not climate change. So democracy and climate change don't go well together because the electoral cycle is much shorter than the timescales of climate change. So I don't need to do anything. I'm going to be retired by then. It's not my problem. So it's an intergenerational problem, and we have to, or an intergenerational issue, and we have to consider whether we would be prepared to say to our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, well, actually, you know, it was more important to us to be comfortable today than it was to make sure that you would be comfortable when you came along. And that's what it boils down to. And I think, you know, we have to think to ourselves, are we prepared to face that uncomfortable truth that currently we're behaving as if our comfort is more important than the comfort of those who come after us? And I don't think we really believe that, but it's certainly how we're behaving. Sorry, I got a bit off the point there, Paul.
Brendan and I were talking half an hour ago in here just about that relationship between science and policy and this kind of ongoing, and it's by no means new, but it's perhaps heightened in the climate change policy arena, which is, you know, the how we marshal scientific evidence in support of political arguments, and how we can marshal scientific evidence without becoming complicit in political processes that some people will say that you have no legitimacy in that arena. You're a scientist, you can give us the facts, but, you know, don't interpret them. That's for the scientists to do. Is that a view that you have any sympathy with? Do you think you should kind of stay in your metaphorical lab with your white coat on and just churn out good quality, reliable, robust facts and then let the politicians do with it as they feel? Or
no, that's not going to cut it, is it? And there are organisations like the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change which attempt exactly to bridge that gap between scientists and policymakers, and they have their little mantra, which is that what we should do should be policy relevant but never policy prescriptive. And I don't think it's a bad mantra, actually. Mm. But what you're saying is, should scientists themselves go out and try to communicate knowledge? And it doesn't work. That's the bottom line. Everything that we know, everything that we observe suggests to us that scientists can talk and talk and talk about the reality of what they observe and what they model about the future, and it makes not a blind bit of difference. So perhaps it's time that we tried something different.
I always like to throw out this quote attributed to Lord Keynes, who said that there's nothing politician likes less than to be well informed,
yeah,
because it makes decision making so difficult.
So much more.
Whether he actually said it or whether he meant what we think he means by that is another matter. Okay, again, just kind of hold your thoughts and questions while we move along the line. So we've had a kind of scientific perspective. Now we've got John from a policymaking environment, somebody who looks to assemble and gather useful and relevant evidence and to marshal that evidence and to kind of present it to his political masters, if you will. How do you think that we have done, if you like, as scientists in presenting you with information that's relevant, timely, digestible, understandable?
I think, and I guess should probably say, firstly, I've come at this story from a little different direction. I'm certainly a policy wonk, and spent a lot of time over the many decades even, several decades even, to try and tell stories to politicians to get them to agree one way or the other. For a fair bit of that time, perhaps since the mid-80s or so, I've been involved in coastal protection and management issues, and of course bumped up against the climate change and sea level rise issue quite early on. In fact, worked on a small Pacific atoll advising the government of Tuvalu about climate change issues in 1991, soon after the first IPCC report came out. Experienced a pretty nasty storm where I could see what was going to happen to those places, which they're still in trouble. So it's very, I don't think that science necessarily has failed in its job. I think it's actually done very well in assembling the facts. What we have missed, I think, and the opportunity we continue to miss is to employ what I would call science educators, or I've got a coastal expert in my group. He's the bridge between the science and informs us policy-wise about how we should marshal, whether we're interpreting the material correctly in our stories that we put together in our papers and briefs and all that sort of thing. And so that role is really, really important and is completely invaluable. The other issue, I think, is not so much the fact that the communication, although that can be problematic, it's more whether the politicians are accepting of the issues. Partly it's too far away, let's not worry about it. But I'd have to say that Queensland has come out of a three-year dark age in relation to a lot of science-related matters. And climate change was the most spectacular topic in which we plunged back into the 700 ADs, I think, and
if only we could have had the CO2 levels at that
time. That's right, it would have been nice. But nevertheless, if there's no appetite, then there's no point running the argument. You're just bashing your head against the brick wall. So for a policy maker that believes the science and has got the story right, it's about taking opportunities that present themselves. And sometimes you just have to sit back and wait. And essentially we've been, cooling our heels on the climate front, particularly on the coastal climate front, for 3 years. And we think we have an opportunity again. We'll see. The government's made a number of lovely promises that look good. They'll be interpreted by many interests, whether they be business interests, the construction and development industry, academics, all sorts of people will interpret those commitments the way that they wish to, or attempt to change them through lobbying, which is their right, of course. But how they actually evolve into the actual final policy and they get implemented, I guess, is a story that's still in the telling.
Can I ask you a rather different question, and it's one that has perplexed me ever since I arrived here kind of 8 years ago, which is trying to make sense of Australia's particular federal solution and the appropriate balance of responsibilities and actions between the different levels of government. So from a state perspective, do you have a view on imagine a kind of ideal, possibly kind of slightly more rational world in which you could rewrite a kind of constitutional settlement. What do you think are the things that are most appropriately done at a state rather than a federal or a local level?
Generically, I'd say the feds have got into way too much business as they should. They run an education department but don't have any schools. They run a health department but don't have any hospitals. The environment department, but except for a few national parks, they don't actually run any bit of the environment. So there's an awful lot of duplication and intergovernmental machinations, which are quite frankly frustrating and in many cases pointless. I can give you an example of over the last 3 years, I think, thanks to Brendan's friends in the IUCN and their influence, the World Heritage Committee, we've been thrashing around between the state and the Commonwealth in terms of trying to find a common policy to deal with issues around the territory. It's impossible. You have meetings of 20 people, foreign affairs, the environment, treasury, that's just on the Commonwealth side, and various state departments. It becomes really frustrating. So I think in many ways, while the Commonwealth certainly have responsibility for foreign affairs and so get involved in a number of these things, they've overreached their remit in a number of areas. I think the environment's one of those. We've ended up with two separate lists of threatened species, most of which overlap. It is unnecessary. The processes of determining what species get onto the lists are exactly the same generally in the states and the Commonwealth. Why do it, those sorts of things. So it's I think, in a more rational world, there would be a clearer division of responsibility. And certainly if an international feature of significance like the Barrier Reef is going backwards, and there needs an intervention, and that should happen. But the intervention should occur in in a more positive way than trying to, override the state.
I was talking to somebody from a local government earlier today and about some of these similar issues, and it struck me that one of the areas where there would appear to be perhaps a greater role for the state is in perhaps mapping and providing information about impacts, likely impacts. I remember some years ago, I think when I was acting director of the Griffith Climate Change Response Programme, I inherited membership of a flood study, a study that took Gaynor as a case study and came up with a model for how to predict the impacts of overland flooding. I only went to the last meeting, and they kind of signed it all off and concluded that, yes, this is good, it's a good working model. The technical guys had said, yeah, it works, it's fine, nobody else. All you've got to do is go away and use it. And what struck me then, and what again is perhaps a peculiarity of the Australian system, is that the contrast between Brisbane, City of Gold Coast, I mean, how many flood modellers have you got at the City of Gold Coast, you know, more than there are in the rest of the state put together, their capacity to take something like that and apply it is reasonable. Hmm. The City of Croydon, where a former colleague from Gold Coast went to work, you know, has a population of 350, it's the size of Belgium, there was her and her husband and somebody that fixed the holes in the roads, and that was about it. You know, their capacity to do anything like that just doesn't exist. Now, the best they could do would be to kind of get together potentially with some neighbouring authorities, you know, fly a few thousand kilometres for a meeting and pool their resources. Do you think that's an area where the state could step in, rather than kind of saying, here's a proven methodology, go away and do it, and potentially come to slightly different, you know, there might still be a bit of variability in it. Is that something that kind of you could do and say, well, this is it, this is the definitive view from the state? I mean, we just have to hope that your sea level rises, you know, either side of the Tweed River aren't too different, otherwise you're going to do some interesting surge rates there.
That's a good point, and I think that's what in some areas we've done, certainly in the coastal hazard areas we've done that. We have published statewide mapping of hazard, incorporated sea level rise. Had to republish the mapping without sea level rise late last year, I might say.
Theoretical.
That's right. So we recently published, so we'll now have to republish those maps. Joys of being close to politicians. Nevertheless, we're up in the sunlight now, not in the dark anymore. So we did do that. So we would be saying to places like Croydon, you know, don't worry about it.
We'll do it.
It's all done for you. Yes. Don't worry. Yes. Yeah. And in any case, you know, like your neighbouring town, Normanton, you're so down, far down the valley that you're going to get flooded either from downhill water or uphill water, regardless. So the best thing you can do is just be prepared to act when the threat arrives. That's your strategy, it's your response strategy. Whereas the Gold Coast, of course, has many more assets. I use the term assets in a very broad sense, people and buildings and infrastructure and all that sort of stuff. At stake, it's quite a different situation, geographic, climatic, similar to Cairns in many ways, short, sharp catchments, steep catchments, lots and lots of rain comes quickly. The coincident opportunity for coincident effects of downhill flooding and uphill flooding are much more likely in areas such as Townsville, for example. So really, they do need to do a lot more work at that very local scale and understand thoroughly what's going to happen and what might happen.
Yes.
So most councils will be more than satisfied with the state mapping that's been provided.
Yeah.
Similarly with the broad scale flood mapping that's been done. But that doesn't mean you might not need to do some more detailed work around your sensitive assets.
Yeah.
They're mostly townships. Most councils will do that. Most coastal councils of any size have done more detailed storm tide mapping, for example, up and down the Queensland east coast, particularly places like Mackay and others that are really, really vulnerable, and Bundaberg, of course, Cobson.
Good. Okay. I mean, my belief and hope is that that's given you enough to get your thoughts going, so that's good. I can see a couple of hands. One, two, and if you could just say who you are before you ask your question.
Peter Gardner, I'm an architect, and lived with a few scientists. And Gene, this is an observation based on your comments of the political cycle. In climate change, I suspect there's also a similar, very short cycle in that the communications of the issues, whereas scientists normally will write a paper, and that paper, if it remains correct, will sit there with respect from all of your peers for decades. And scientists are renowned for that, and they go back and they look at these papers from three or four decades ago, and the information is good, and they use it, and they follow through. In the political environment, I suspect that anything in the climate change area that's over maybe 4 or 5 years old will be deemed to be irrelevant for political purposes. And so my comment is that perhaps scientists need to change their behaviour and rewrite the same paper every 2 years so that it remains relevant, and perhaps just change the date so that it can be quoted as something from 2013 if somebody's using it now.
Yeah, so in a way, I mean, I don't know, John can comment on this. Increasingly, you find that the politicians, right down to local government level, are aware of the assessments that are done by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, although that's targeted at international negotiations. In fact, everybody knows about them, everybody uses them. They come out every 5 or 6 years, and they tend to be the go-to place to get the most up-to-date knowledge. I mean, one of the problems with them is they're not very accessible, are they?
No, I think
do you mean that in terms of their kind of
their readability again, and their comprehensiveness, and they do try to produce summaries, but they're actually not wonderful, and probably not going to be done to improve that.
Generally what we wait for, if our minister really asks for the document, which is not very often, they'd much rather have someone give them the 10 bullet point, one pager, which is about all the minister can read. No disrespect to any minister, there's so much on I don't read much more on a page either. it's got to be quite digestible. They come from all sorts of backgrounds, and it's rare that a minister and their portfolio, minister's background and their portfolio, actually coincide. Pretty rare. So even the reports that are prepared by the IPCC, which are for policymakers, the summary reports and the regional summary reports are pretty difficult to hand over to the minister. The further refinement of those produced directly by the CSIRO are much better, and some of the bond products are pretty good as well. But really, for a top level politician, they're not going to have the capacity or the time, to deal with the detail, and we'll rely very much on their staff and their policy folk summarising for them what it is that's most important. And you can do that. The most important message out of the last several IPCC reports is that not much has changed. The degree of certainty has improved about what's going to change. But in terms of should we move from 0.5 to 0.8, 0.8 to 1, that hasn't changed much at all. The scenarios are broadly the same, the range is broadly the same. Where you pick which emissions scenario you pick, and where in that range of say sea level rises or temperature rises you pick,
it's really a political decision. But at the end of the day, it hasn't changed all that much.
Except that we're tracking along the high.
Yeah, we are tracking along the high. Which is why we would argue as policymakers that you should be conservative and take the business as usual scenario and pick the high number.
Brendan, you were just going to say something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, you're faced... I mean, this is no different to any other environmental problem that's informed and framed by science. It's the role of the policy advisors to take the science and summarise it and pull out the key points and translate that into policy options and implications. I mean, as I think both of you have said tonight, the problem with climate change is really not the science. The science is excellent. The work of the IPCC, I think, is one of it's fantastic. It's an extraordinary exercise by any measure to try and synthesise what's known about a very complex area. The real issue we face, I think, is that we are dealing with a problem that can't really be dealt with by the normal political discourse. It's a problem that I think really needs to be elevated out above and outside that. In the same way that national security issues are. I mean, we don't have any political debate about whether we should have a defence force, or even what the size of the defence force budget should be. No one blinked an eyelid when they said we should buy 34 new jet fighters at a cost of how much?
Billions each.
Or that we need a new submarine fleet, or I just heard this week a new frigate fleet to combat all the other submarines that our neighbours are buying at a cost of hundreds of billions of dollars. No one bats an eyelid, no one questions it. And that's because national defence as a national security issue has been taken out of the political football field. And really, climate change, I think, requires the same response. And we've got an inkling of what that might look like from Great Britain, where we've had more of a bipartisan approach than what we've seen here. And when I've talked to British colleagues about this, they perhaps, I'm not sure how true it is, but they suggest that one of the sources of that was when this came out, Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister and she had a degree in chemistry. Right? So, there might be some basis to that. Certainly China is having a very different policy response. And again, at least a half of elected Chinese representatives have a science or engineering degree. So again, I think it is possible to reframe climate change as a global or national security issue, try and take it out of this kind of political football that we've got bogged down into in Australia. In which case, that will enable science to take its proper role and for us to have more informed, kind of open public debate about what the options are. Because there's a lot of very hard decisions to make. There's going to be a lot of winners and losers along the way. And it's something we can't put off by keeping it within this kind of current political frame.
Now, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes.
Hi, I'm Jessica Walker from SEQ Catchments. I guess I'm just wanting to build on both the point that you made, Jean, where you're talking about that climate change and democracy perhaps don't go hand in hand, and the whole concept of removing it outside that democracy that Brendan, you made. But if it's the politicians who are perhaps not as on board or are causing difficulties for things to go forward, what about the people who are actually putting those politicians in those places? If we're talking about communication and how do we actually get, or perhaps do you think that there's a role for a greater involvement, a greater communication with the general public to actually get this, to weigh up those balances and to get it put a lot more on the national agenda, but from that community base as opposed to just coming in from the top-down science politician base. Sorry, that was for both of you, eh?
Yeah, I mean, the basic problem, I think, is that, if you look at all the psychological and social surveys that have been done by Griffith University, Joe Risser and CSIRO and others, less than 10% of the Australian population could be called climate deniers. It's less than 10%, 6, 7, 8%. The overwhelming majority, you know, nearly 90% accept that climate change is happening, and the high 80% accept that there's a human forcing it. So what's going on? Well, you know, there's powerful vested interests, you know, that have a lot of capital invested in fossil fuel economy, fossil fuel energy production and use of it. So, you know, we've got power issues, you know, going on. Science has been used as a political football. So I wasn't saying take it out of democracy. I was saying let's get more democratic about dealing with what the actual options are for, you know, addressing this problem, both mitigation and adaptation. But clearly, you know, the answer lies in more democracy, having more engaged and informed citizens thinking and talking about this and writing to their elected leaders about it.
I'm not going to go along the row for every question, so Dorian, I think you were next.
Dorian Ehrhardt from the Local Government Association of Queensland. My question is for you, Jean. I know that as part of this next phase of NCARF, you've been travelling around the country talking to end users, specifically local governments, about adaptation and their needs. I'm not sure whether or not you're in a position to do this yet, but are you able to give us a sense of where local governments are at nationally and what is at topmost in their minds in terms of where they've got to go to? Are we way back at the starting line, or are we making some forward progress? Because I know irrespective of state and federal policy, this level of government has identified that it is something that they need to deal with, but perhaps might struggle getting their heads around it.
I think that what I observe and what I hear is that local governments are ready and willing to act, but they don't feel able to. They actually feel quite blocked from being able to act because increasingly what they say is, they want a benchmark. So we went to a meeting in Ballina, and there was a presentation by the New South Wales government about what they call those stage two coastal reforms, which are wonderful. I mean, there's scenarios, there's manuals, there's thinking around financing, there's everything, except there is no benchmark. And the people who were there, who were all local government representatives, they said, actually, you know, we're not that bothered about having scenarios, and we don't really need a manual. We had an old one and it wasn't too bad, and now you're giving us a new one and it's not that different, and yes, it's good to think about financing. But what we really need is a benchmark, because we need you to tell us what level of sea level rise we have to plan to. If you don't tell us that, our community is never going to be accepting if it's apparent that we're acting in isolation and alone. So it's all around how you empower local governments, local councils who are wanting to act, who are ready to act, how you empower them to act. That's what we're hearing.
John, did you want to add to that or not?
I guess I'm hearing the same things, particularly from officers, politicians and local government vary in their views, like politicians everywhere. I think I'm not sure whether the same statistics would apply to politicians in terms of the 80-20 statistic or whatever it was that you mentioned, but I think certainly from the officers, probably from the CEOs down, that if something's mandated, then they're much happier. Someone else to blame.
Yeah, it gives them security to act, and I think, fair enough, local councils are very close to their community, whereas state governments and federal governments, it seems to me it's more straightforward for them to act, because they just sit a little bit more
distant. And in Queensland, we did have that mandated position for about months, I think.
Yes, sir.
Jeff Vincent from Brisbane Region Environment Council. I have a question to John Lane. Has EHP mapped climate change corridors and refugia, and what policy level is this going to progress to? Concepts or strategy or consultations?
As you know, Ted, we have a number of quite excellent tools that we use to map ecological values across the state and through the biodiversity planning assessment methodology. And we have, in fact, that includes corridors, includes refugia area, includes areas of high endemism, and other high values that we consider of state importance. So that material's there, it's accessible, available on the web. People that are using GIS can download the data and play to their heart's content. The next part of your question is a bit trickier, as you know. I've got a feeling you might have asked me this question in some other forum.
but may well again in the future.
Yeah, no doubt. Next ministerial roundtable. That's a question I can't answer. I don't know what this government will do in terms of establishing a biodiversity strategy. As you know, the last government, whittled away or took the knife to the definition of what constituted state value ecosystems or biodiversity values, and became quite a narrowly focused set of values, essentially around what was already protected by legislation. Some regional ecosystems, some species, habitat, those sorts of things. And certainly not corridors and such things like that. We're, I think, hopeful as a department that that once the dust settles on, and the government settles in, assuming it hangs around long enough to settle in, we'll be able to make some move in that direction. The proposals of the government that we should be re-establishing a strategy and implementing that in a variety of ways, particularly through the planning and development system, to ensure that those values are given some protection. That's only one angle, of course. There's a lot of rehabilitation that's necessary. Many of our larger patches, forest and other areas of ecological value are being separated from each other. A fair bit of work involved in that and cost. So, hopefully we'll head down that direction, but I can't say that as yet.
As a very well, possibly helpful response from Tim Mulheron to the LGAQ that was published in January and contains a number of responses to a number of questions put to them by the LGAQ, and I'm just skimming through there. I can't see anything on biodiversity.
I mean, it may come up under some other headings, but it doesn't leap out as a heading
in its own right in that document.
Whether that his statement in January of, which I suspect was written by a Labour group that perhaps wasn't anticipating forming the next government, it might now be somewhat different, but it wasn't there. Now, Carver, I think you were next. Then, if I remember, then we're going to you, and then did I see your hand up? Okay, we've got one and two.
Yeah, I'm Carver, environmental planning graduate from Griffith. First, I give John a good news that I don't know how familiar you are with Griffith Environmental School, but our school trains environmental planners that can write reports.
Go ahead.
That
all
in case if you want to recruit.
He'll give you his card afterwards.
What is your thought about the EPBC Act? The previous government, Queensland government, was given more authority over that Act. Would you demand more authority, or what would happen to the future of that?
I think this new Queensland government has made it quite clear that it doesn't want to take on the decision-making responsibility of Commonwealth. So whereas previously the last government and other governments, or state governments around Australia, were keen to take on that responsibility through what are called bilateral agreements, this Queensland government, the Queensland government, has made a firm decision that it won't be pursuing that anymore. We do have a bilateral agreement under the EPBC Act around the assessment part of, the Environment Protection and Biodiversity Conservation Act, which is the Commonwealth Environment Legislation. So we do have an agreement under that Act which provides that our assessment of major projects, subject to environmental impact assessment, we essentially do on their behalf. So we agree in terms of reference and we run the process. So there's not duplication. That was happening before. A company would have to run two separate processes for the same facility. So we do have an agreement around that just to make things easier. But at the end of the day, they make their decision and we make ours. So I think it'll continue on. There's proposed changes, by the way, to set up these agreements. I assume other states are still pursuing. Well, I'm really stuck in the Senate, so I don't think anything's going to happen anytime soon.
The phase of a number of initiatives.
Yes.
Hi, my name's Sabah, I'm with SQ Catchments as well. This is a question directed more towards yourself, Dean. We recently watched a webinar on from CSIRO, I think the Professor was Zoe Levingston, and she had presented some information around communication around climate change adaptation, which I found extremely interesting from a social science perspective, about how people take up information and that simply providing people with information isn't the solution, that people can feel quite disempowered by the information that they're receiving in the media or whatever forms that they take up information from friends, family or other sources. And I guess just wanting to know your thoughts a little bit around that, you know, NCARF does come, I guess, from a more science perspective, but how you see that integration with that social science communication, how we are communicating messages to the community and trying to empower them and make them feel motivated again about climate change issues.
Okay, so that's a very good, very complex question, so I'll do my best with it and I will go and watch the webinar because it does sound very interesting. What we have learnt in NCARF is exactly that, that you can't just deliver information to people and expect them to take it up. That model will not work. One of the most successful initiatives that NCARF has undertaken has been to develop and write 12 policy guidance briefs on key questions around water, all in adaptation, but things like water, local governments and how they adapt, human health and adaptation, indigenous communities and adaptation. There's 12 of them. And we did them by holding very small workshops for half a day where we brought, by invitation only, people who we identified as key stakeholders. And those stakeholders were all people working in the community that we were interested in. So people working in hospitals for the health one, people working in the ambulance service for the health one, so on and so forth. And what we didn't bring into that room was researchers. So we would bring a couple and we would take them out for a meal the night before and we would brief them very carefully. And the message in the briefing was, do not talk. Sit there and listen. Give a little presentation when you're asked for 10 minutes just to entertain people and give them a break. But don't say anything, and it was fascinating to watch them. You know, they'd sit there and they could manage it for a couple of hours, and it got more and more difficult for them. Some of them broke entirely, and then a volume of conversation came from them. But generally speaking, they're very good. We used them as rapporteurs, we used them to help us organize it, but we used them to entertain for 10 minutes, but they did, you know, they kept quiet, and that meant that we got a huge amount of information from the invited stakeholders in the room, the decision makers, policy makers, the practitioners, that we would, I think, never have got otherwise. And we used those to create these policy guidance briefs, which then went on to be very, very successful. And people still say to us, oh, yes, we still do. It's a very useful document. They don't say anything particularly groundbreaking, but they're just in the right language and they make the right points. So that sort of, it's not even co-production of knowledge, is it? It's a sort of community practice that's generating a network that can communicate and share knowledge. And I think the key question for scientists is how you take that community and inject new information into it. And I don't know how you do that, because if you don't have that facility, you know, it's going to go round and round in circles and there isn't going to be new information. So I think the key role for scientists to understand, they have to be, scientists have to learn to be the servant of the process. And the process is driven by the practitioners and the decision makers. And we have to learn how to serve that process and how to inject information, new information into it. Don't know if that helps you. Don't know if it answers your question.
I mean, I suspect that we know that the way not to do it would be for for scientists to kind of flaunt their expertise and superior knowledge, speak in convoluted language and throw out acronyms left, right and centre, and if anyone has the temerity to challenge them, then, you know, disrespect them in public and then wonder why nobody's engaging with them, you know, that, and there's probably, there has been quite a bit of that, and there will probably continue to be that in the future, but, you know, we know that, that's just a way of getting people offside, but...
And I think what this professor is trying to say is that we really need to understand what people value.
Yes.
What are the things that they care about, and then communicate to them in that way, rather than coming from what we care about and telling them what we know, do it the other way around.
If I tell you your values are wrong, that's probably not the best way to persuade you around to anything. I mean, I sometimes wonder about the and I seem to remember when you first arrived, Brendan, we had some interesting discussions about the kind of the political morality and the political tactics of using or avoiding using certain words. And the words climate and change might be two words that in some circumstances you might decide, one might decide, I might decide not to use, because I know it's going to just wind a lot of people up. If I have a conversation about building community resilience, about preparing for disasters and risk management and things, people will engage me in conversation. Once I throw those C words into it, there will be some people who, you know, that's it, they're off. You know, that's the red rag, and we can have a good fight, a good argument, but we won't have a productive conversation. Now I know other people don't have that view. So I'll be Tony Jones and say that I'll take that as a statement rather than a comment rather than a question. Now I've lost track. Zhuzhu had a, so we've got one there, and then one there.
Hi, I'm Zhuzhu from Griffith University. And I have a question that is sort of going back to the original on, is changing, are we adapting, and taking the question a little bit out of what we're talking about. But I'm interested in what you think. How is Australia and Queensland adapting to the global climate change policies, targets, and trends that we're seeing in other countries? Say this China's commitment to renewable energy targets and the commitment to green economy. The fossil fuel investment movement, which is a lot smaller in scale, but it's still there, gaining some ground. What does that mean for climate change adaptation?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the things we have to adapt to is our use of energy and the kind of energy we use. So in that sense, you know, our mitigation responses are, you can use the term adaptation very, very broadly in that sense. One of the major changes we have to bring about is how we use energy and what sources of energy we use, you know, fundamentally. But, you know, clearly, you know, there's a couple of countries who are major emitters who are out of step. Canada and Australia are the two that stand out at the moment. You know, the government, to its credit, has just released a discussion paper asking for input into its determination as to what emission reduction commitments it will take to the climate change treaty negotiations. Of course, in Paris in December this year, is where the world's nations are meant to agree upon the next major climate change agreement. Everyone's agreed it's going to be ambitious, it's going to involve commitments from all countries, but it's taken a novel approach. Rather than negotiating what the emission reduction commitments will be each country is going to be allowed to determine for itself what it thinks it should do. And these go by the name of INDCs. Independent, I wrote this down because I always forget it. It's a terrible acronym. They're the intended nationally determined commitments. INDCs. Remember that acronym. You heard it here first. So everyone, you know, every country has agreed to have some kind of national dialogue and to come up with its emission reduction commitments. Australia's currently is it will reduce its emissions by 5% of what they were in the year 2000 by the year 2020. How much is that? That's equivalent to half of 1 year's worth of our emissions. Is that a lot? Is that enough? Is that fair? The big question will be, from a global point of view, is when every nation's INDCs are in, we can add them up and see what it comes to. You know, does it stay within the carbon budget that will deliver the 2-degree safeguard, or will it blow that away and will it be delivering a 3.5-degree world or a 4-degree world? You know, we don't know. So it's very good that the Australian government has released a discussion paper on this. It's asking for invitations. So the Abbott government's official policy is it's that 5% plus a commitment to upgrading that should there be a new global agreement that involves all the countries, including all the major committees, which is what we're heading to. So what would be a fair emission target for Australia is a national discussion we need to have.
National conversation.
National conversation we need to be having. But if we're to hit the 2-degree safeguard, there's some concrete kind of numbers we can look at. So I mentioned before there's the global carbon budget for 2 degrees, and that's about 34 years worth of current emissions. Well, so the real question is, how do you distribute that fairly amongst the nations of the world? Like, who gets it? And how is it to be fairly allocated? One proposal is you do it on a per capita basis, on the basis that every human's got an equal right to whatever the Earth can absorb in terms of carbon. First principle of the UN Declaration of Human Rights, each person is born with equal people. Well, if you do that, if you allocate that budget to nations based upon their population, Australia's allocation is 7 years of its current emissions. And we're currently committed to reducing our emissions by half of 1 year. So,
and we achieve most of that by chopping down trees in Queensland. We actually didn't do anything. We just stopped.
Which is another issue about how we do the accounting.
That's
so,
good. So
you know, I would encourage everyone here to give this some thought and write a submission, or if you're from an organisation or entity of any kind, to put in a submission on this. It's a really important issue, and it's a really it's a really good opportunity to take this have a national conversation about it. And can I say it's completely coupled to the adaptation issue, because the greater or less success we have with mitigation with greenhouse gas emissions, it completely affects the kind of the hazards we're going to have to face and adapt.
One of the dangers, if I may, about this having this conversation is that, I guess, in of all the climate-related discussions, this is probably the most complex in terms of language and getting notions across. So for those communicators out there, getting information into the hands of people in a manner that can be understood is pretty important. And I think there will be a fair bit of attempts to confuse the discussions by making it too complex and too convoluted by certain organisations and in sectors that have interests in preserving the status quo. So I think that'll be something to look out for, trying to bring it down to a situation that where it's understandable what people are talking about. Talk about billions of tonnes of CO2 equivalent, if you like, but what is that? How does it compare to the size of this room? Yeah, that sort of stuff is really important in the conversation. I'll be interested to see whether the Commonwealth, when they're leading this conversation or trying to elicit comments from the community, are prepared to invest in that, in that interaction, in that conversation appropriately. I might say they've left it pretty late.
One of the problems is, I mean, it's not just...
They're due in May.
We make it more difficult than it needs to be, and I think governments are responsible in part. So we don't even use, for example, a common base year which to assess the reductions that we're going to undertake. Every government's working to a different base year, 1990, 2000. Conjure a number out of the sky, one that will make you look really good, because it gives you a very large figure for your reductions that are easy to achieve. So governments are a little bit responsible for some of the confusion that exists and could do a lot better.
Very good. We've got a question there then.
And just very quickly, if you were to the volume of a ton of CO2 at mean sea level, pressure is about the size of a 3-bedroom house.
There you go.
I must admit that when everything's represented in terms of the Sydney Harbour, I still. Maybe it's because I haven't been here long enough.
A bit longer.
Than I'll go. Yes, I understand entirely what that means now. But
Pradesh Ramai from Gold Coast, but I asked this as a practicing planner. I was part of the group in 2002 that put forward the first state coastal management plan. I think it was one of the first time we had a sea level rise policy statement in that, which basically said for planners, watch the space. 14 years later, we're still watching the space. And for that planner, for planners practically, the question we're all asked is, what are we adapting to? At what point, is this a realistic question to ask? When will we know what we will be adapting to? And what's preventing us from getting to that point? Is it technology? Is it lack of resources? Is it that the science is still evolving? I'll put it to all three.
It's politics, in a word. As a practicing planner, you'll know that every decision that gets made in your sphere of work is a political decision, essentially. Something I could never get across to my co-students when I was doing planning. Back in the 70s, that in fact it's essentially, it's not an art, it's not a science, but it's a bit of political science, if you like, it's the whole planning business. So really, yes, that was a first toe in the water. If you recall back then, we were starting to use historic sea level rises in the calculations for our coastal hazards and erosion prone areas back in the late 90s, which was 300 millimetres or so, which is still the same, hasn't actually changed from the last 200 years or so. So it hasn't started to trend up that rise. We expect that to happen in 15 or 20 years. It did take from 2008 to 2012 to actually argue through government the need for to set a standard for sea level rise and other matters that were in the state coastal plan at the time. We got it in place, and I might say this is a good lesson for anyone that wants to get into this sort of business. The only reason we actually got the state coastal plan across the line at that point was because of the cyclone Yasi. No other reason. Everyone just, wet their pants, and let it hit Cairns or Townsville. Complete number mayhem. So that jolted the politicians so much that they accepted our position. The advice was coming that was finally introduced to law about a month before the government was turned out, and about a month later it was given the job. So that's the answer. That's political decision making.
We're getting close to the time when we need to wrap things up, so I'll leave that answer there. Michael,
I'll try and be quick. I'm Michael House from the School of Environment. I was one of the researchers that Jean took on tour and had to sit there and hold my tongue. That's why you encouraged me to drink wine the night before. One of the things that we did actually with our research was to spend a lot of time with practitioners and ask them what they thought they could do about improving disaster risk management and climate change adaptation. And that actually seemed to also change their ideas about what we could do. I was just wondering, Jean, from all the stuff you've done in terms of that engagement, have you seen, or what kind of changes have you actually seen in the practitioners?
I would say, so Michael was one of the good ones, he did keep quiet. Thank you, Michael. I would say that the vast majority of the people that we deal with who are practitioners are convinced of the need to act and they want to act. What they don't feel is that they have the tools that will enable them to act. And amongst the tools I include things like sort of a sense of legal protection, a sense of support from their governments, whether it be the state government or the federal government, as well as the tools around, you know, how do you cost the benefit. How do you evaluate the cost of adaptation? How do you evaluate the benefits and what sort of methodologies that you have to do as well? So there's a high degree of acceptance out there amongst practitioners. Was it you who said that you don't meet many skeptics at the end of a fire hose?
Yeah.
Yes, of course. And I think that sense of the need to act goes throughout the whole of the community that needs to do that feels the sense of the need to do something about adaptation. And you do find good examples taking place out there. For example, what the Water Corporation in the Southwest WA has done around protecting their water resources against this continuing drought that seems to be related to climate change. So there are some very good examples out there, but they tend to occur either when something like Cyclone Yasi has taken place and people can see very clearly the need to act, or the case of the Water Corp faced with this continuing drought and the necessity to act now. Everybody else is being barred from action because of the political circumstance, because there's something better to spend the money on, because adaptation and climate change are a shadowy concept that isn't necessarily something that we need to deal with now when there are so many other pressing calls on our money. Now, that isn't true, it's false, but it's something that politicians can rely on in order to defer action against climate change.
An ultimate question, yeah?
Leah Dixon from City of Gold Coast in waste management. I'm a scientist and I've been working in research and policy in three levels of government during my working life. And I completely recognise all those things you talk about with the barriers that occur in government and with politicians. But I watch different publications and I see that from the perspective of being in government, I look outside and see that private enterprise you see these good news stories about even, you know, quite large corporations making changes. I mean, you talked about it being an ephemeral sort of topic, but they're actually making changes in things like that are quite solid, like carbon footprints and emission, reducing emissions, etc. My question is, what's happening in that space between the interaction between scientists and, and government, different levels of government, because it's happening quite randomly, it seems, in private enterprise. It's something, they have a corporate commitment, but that's just that corporation or that's just that company. How can we, bring them into a space where they're taking more general notice of the science and maybe forget about that banging our heads against the wall with policy and start working very much towards private enterprise, which maybe can do something.
Well, that's a good point. I think it's absolutely right.
But is there, are there any organisations or some kind of groups that are working towards that at this point?
There are leaders in all sectors. There's no doubt about that. Some of them are quite spectacular in what they do. I think in many ways they hide their lights under a bushel a bit. There are some big land development companies, for example, in southeast Queensland that are doing a sterling job. They might argue about why the government chose the land that they're developing as whether it was suitable for development or not, but leaving that aside, having chosen that particular parcel, they're doing a pretty good job of, particularly in the water management area, wastewater management area, stormwater management area. Less so in the climate adaptation building side of things, but that's happening in some places. I think the real problem is that there are companies that do that because they think it's the right thing to do, and also they might be able to sell their product at a premium, which is an added bonus, of course. But I'm not sure that we're seeing those leaders being able to influence their industry. And I know that from my experience, most vociferous opponents of the coastal planning work that we did from about 2008 through to 2012 was the construction and development industry. Yet some of the best examples of application of climate sensitive design and adaptability were coming from some of their own members.
And I think it's often the individual CEO who is the driver of change. So if you take, you know, a huge organisation like Lever Brothers, which is a world industry, you know, so their CEO Paul Post is a great believer in the necessity to do something about climate change, and so the way that company is doing its business is being transformed. But it's because of him, and you can see when he goes that impetus may well be lost.
It's very isolated, and I just wondered about how you step it up.
Yeah.
So I think there's, you know, there's a couple of really powerful drivers for change in the private sector. One is certainly government policy. If we had a price on carbon, it would be a major change. And similarly, certain state guidelines can really help drive adaptation in different sectors. Get the right policies in the coastal zone, and they can drive adaptation. But there's two other areas which will really drive change in the private sector, and that's stock exchange demanding that as part of companies, listed companies' reporting requirements, they report their exposures and risk associated with climate change in their annual reports. And also the insurance industry. I mean, this is happening at the at the global reinsurance level. Swiss Re and Munich Re are two big global reinsurers. They've got huge climate research divisions. I mean, hundreds of people who are doing work in this area, looking at hazards and risks associated with climate and disasters, etc. So between the insurance industry and the stock market and government policy, if we had a lot of kind of activism there, that would really change the landscape for private sector generally.
Last question.
My name's Chris Boshoff. I sell property on the Gold Coast, this fabulous floodplain city that we have. And my question is, or statement basically, to everybody in the room, to the engineers, the planners, the architects, is to start advising us, where do we build the dikes? Think about Holland. That's got nothing to do with politics, it's got to do with reality, as you said. The stock exchange, insurers are going to start demanding it. Is it a 50-year plan? Is it a 100-year plan? We need to start planning that now. 95% of this country lives on the beach. So we should be looking at that now.
Oh, well, I think that's
we shouldn't waste our time on climate change. If we 22 million people in this country, there are cities in China that have got more people in one city than what we have in this whole country. I think we're wasting our time with all this climate change, trying to put a price on climate, on emissions. That's just getting money out of us cash cows. That doesn't work. We need to look at the practical side of it.
I think there's two sides to that story. One is that I think we do need to have a policy that essentially ensures that we put a cap on the amount of carbon going into the atmosphere eventually. Otherwise, it will just become a continually bigger problem, and you have to keep building your dikes higher and higher. But on the other side, I think you're quite right, in as much as we do need to start planning now and over a much longer time frame than traditional town planning, land use planning is undertaking at the moment. Generally speaking, most town planning sort of revise every 10 years, maybe every 15 years. But really, when we're talking about these changes affecting low-lying areas, whether they be floodplains or coastal areas, we really need to be talking about the next 30, 40, 50, 80, 100 years, and then beyond that, but we start to get well beyond the scope of what we can do. So yes, you do need to do that. We've had one pilot project in Townsville City, which is a city that's probably more at risk than the Gold Coast. You may not believe that, there's many other towns in Queensland that are more at risk than the Gold Coast. Where we did go through as a combined effort with the Local Government Association of Queensland, the Commonwealth Government provided some cash, Town and City Council was involved, and the state was involved. Where we systematically went through each of the urban areas at risk based on our mapping of hazard areas, which incorporated the sea level rise factor to 2100. Identified the nature of the assets in those areas, what we would have to do to protect them, or what would you do, because there's various things you can do in terms of responding to those risks. You can defend, as the Dutch have done. You can, I guess you can live with it, as people all around the world do already. So you can accommodate the risks. Or you can retreat, which people have done over the millennia as well. Clearly, the Aboriginal people in this country retreated 10,000-12,000 years ago when 100 metre plus sea level rise is occurring at the end of the Ice Age. So I think, and we will certainly be encouraging councils, giving support to councils, one of the commitments of the new government to undertake this much longer term coastal hazard adaptation planning. And it's not, it is in some ways a frightening prospect, because we have to start talking to people now about what that might mean for their communities, but not now necessarily. If they're being damaged by coastal hazards right now, then it's today's climate that's affecting them, not the climate that we expect to find 20, 30, 50, 80 years time. But you do have to begin to prepare for that. You know, we have to understand, well, what are we going to do with this part of the world? You know, clearly we've got a lot of assets, they're very expensive assets. We can't afford to retreat from the Gold Coast. I think most people would accept that as a reasonable proposition. What do we have to do in terms of protecting that asset from the projected changes? And when do we have to do it, and how we pay for it? You know, they're the sort of questions you need to be asking now, and so progressively as time goes on, and then of course as information and knowledge improves, you review that, you know, every 10 or 15 years and make sure you're still on the right track. So that's the sort of vision we have in terms of and encouraging councils that money, actually this time it's going to be better than last time where we beat them over there with a stick and said you must do it, encouraging councils to undertake these sorts of long-term plans and identify, understand, and have their communities understand what it is that has to happen and when. It's not tomorrow, you know. Don't panic.
And I suspect, I mean, a couple of you have mentioned, you know, insurance industry, and I suspect it's the insurance industry and valuation industry that may well be some of the more significant players in how we plan for the future. It will have more influence on what gets built and where than planners and politicians. I was just reminded when I, not long after I arrived here at Griffith in Australia, I met someone, I'm sure it was somebody before your time, Chris, who was telling me how, you know, in the murky distant past, it was not unheard of for the sellers of off-the-plan properties on perhaps sandbanks in the Broadwater to helicopter in their respective clients at low tide, and the trick was to ensure they're back on the helicopter and off before the water rose and the land that they were going to be buying disappeared under water.
That's Brisbane.
it couldn't happen on the Gold Coast, of course. Right, I'm going to call a halt to the proceedings there and to first thank John, Jean, and Brendan for their contributions, to thank you for coming and for presenting them with such interesting and challenging questions. To thank Professor Henley for hosting this event, and to Damien and to others who've organized it so smoothly. I do have a bullet point, and that's what would be on the sheet of paper if I could read it, which says, encourage audience to fill in survey, which is the small piece of paper that you're possibly sitting on at this moment in time. So if you'd like to extract that, fill it in and leave it somewhere, perhaps on the table there before you, as you go out, before you go. On that table, there's some other collateral that relates to the work of Griffith Sciences. And there's also a flyer for a marvellous book about the impacts of climate change in this hotspot of southeast Queensland, which is available at a generously discounted price if you fill in the appropriate form in all the fact that it's expired in December last year. I'm sure CSIRO Publishing will honour that if it's sent in on that basis. So perhaps there are some refreshments now outside. Outside and to the right. Hope you can join us there and continue the conversation for the next 30 or 40 minutes or so. And if you can now join me in thanking our panel and yourselves.